Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. We've been learning a lot about how DNA is used to carry and pass on genetic information. It's a process that most living things are very good at, despite being rather complicated. But sometimes variations and even some surprises can occur. Let's look at this adorable golden brush-tailed possum. Now, you might be more familiar with possums that look like this. The color of our very cute golden possum is the result of a mutation. A mutation is any change in the structure or composition of the genetic material. Are mutations beneficial or harmful? Well, they could be either. In the golden brush-tailed possum's case, it's mostly harmful. Being such a bright color makes it stand out, so it's more easily picked off by predators. As a result, they are rarely seen in the wild. But where does the word mutation come from? Do you want to learn some more Latin? It actually comes up a lot in science. Mutatis mutandis is Latin for once the changes have been made. This is where the word mutate comes from, meaning to change. Specifically, in our case, changes to the DNA. Remember that most humans will undergo around 10 quadrillion cell divisions over the course of a long life, and the DNA has to be copied each and every time. You probably know how hard it is just to copy a small number of math formulas correctly. Imagine having to do this 10 quadrillion times. At some point, differences between the copy and the original are bound to occur. After today's lesson, you'll be able to determine the outcome of various point mutations, explain examples of chromosomal mutations, describe possible effects of mutations. The first type of mutation we'll talk about is the simplest type to understand, point mutations. These mutations only involve a change in a single nucleotide base pair, and the simplest type of point mutation is the case of substitution, where one base takes the place of another. Let's look at an example. If our DNA template strand has the codon GAT, it would be transcribed with the mRNA codon CUA. During translation, this would make the amino acid leucine. Now, what if, perhaps during DNA replication, the T in our template strand was accidentally replaced with an A? Now our template strand codon is GAA, which would be transcribed as CUU. This would be translated to the amino acid leucine. Well, that was fortunate. Even with the mistake, we still made the same amino acid. When this happens, it's called a silent mutation. Unfortunately, not all mutations are silent. Let's look at another example. Our original DNA codon reads GTC, which gets transcribed into an mRNA codon of CAG. This codes for the amino acid glutamine in translation. This time, the mutation made during DNA replication changes our original DNA codon to GTA instead of GTC. This will transcribe to CAU and translate to the amino acid histidine. Yikes, that's not what we meant to make at all. When the mutation causes a different amino acid than the original to be made, it is called a missense mutation. Point mutations also include insertions or deletions, where an extra base gets added into the DNA strand or one gets completely deleted. These are especially harmful because they end up affecting more than one amino acid in a domino effect that ripples all the way down the amino acid chain. Let's look at an example to see the carnage. This time, we'll start with a set of four codons on our DNA template. we would transcribe the mRNA strand using our base pairing rules, then translate those mRNA codons into amino acids. We end up with arginine, threonine, phenylalanine, and histidine. This time, however, instead of a nucleotide getting replaced, what if a T is simply added into the chain during replication? All the other nucleotides have to shift down one spot to make room. This completely disrupts our groups of three. Our new DNA codons will be arranged differently, and so will the corresponding mRNA codons. The first codon still makes arginine, so we might think we've lucked out with a silent mutation, but the rest of the chain isn't so lucky. It continues with tyrosine, leucine, and proline, so the rest of the chain will be unrecognizable. This type of mutation is called a frameshift mutation because everything shifts down, disrupting the codon sets, and ultimately the amino acids that get made. Remember that proteins are very specific and have to be made of just the right amino acids in order to be folded and function properly. So, a frameshift mutation is usually disastrous in terms of making a useful protein. And the same situation could occur if a nucleotide is deleted. We said that point mutations are the result of one nucleotide that has mutated or changed. But what about large sections of nucleotides, or even whole chromosomes, being copied or passed on with mutations? These are called chromosomal mutations. They can change the structure or number of chromosomes present in the cell. Many times, chromosomal mutations are the result of mutations that occur during meiosis, which, remember, is the process that creates gametes, or reproductive cells. Remember what happens during anaphase 1 of meiosis? The homologous chromosomes separate and end up going to different cells. However, if the chromosomes do not separate and end up going to the same cell, look what happens. We end up with two gametes that have two copies of the chromosome and two gametes that have none. This is called a non-disjunction and is one of the most common types of chromosomal mutations. Let's think about what's going to happen to these gametes now, which did not form as expected. Of course, most organisms have more than one pair of chromosomes, so we'll pretend that this is chromosome number 21 in a human cell. We can assume all other chromosomes are separated as expected and are not pictured. During fertilization, the mutated cell will join with another haploid cell that doesn't have the mutation. If the empty gamete here, which doesn't have chromosome 21, joins with a typical haploid cell, the resulting cell will only have one copy of chromosome 21. Chances are this zygote will not survive long enough to be born. But what if one of the cells with two copies of chromosome 21 joins with a typical haploid cell having one copy of chromosome 21? The resulting cell will have three copies of chromosome 21. This is known as trisomy 21 and leads to the condition more commonly known as Down syndrome. Approximately one in every 700 babies born has Down syndrome. Each individual living with the condition experiences its effects across a very large spectrum. It can affect the development of physical features, sometimes resulting in flattened facial features, small hands and feet, and poor muscle tone. It also affects brain development. But how does having an extra chromosome cause so many different effects? It is thought that the extra copy of chromosome 21 affects the expression of genes on many other chromosomes. Some genes are underutilized, while others are overutilized. Though Down syndrome is one of the most well-known chromosomal mutations, it's far from being the only possible change to the structure of chromosomes. Other types of chromosomal mutations include deletion, duplication, and inversion. Many times, these mutations occur during crossing over, when genetic material is exchanged between chromosomes in meiosis. If the chromosomes are not aligned properly when the exchange takes place, genes can end up in a different place or be missing completely. Another type of chromosomal mutation is polyploidy. We've talked a lot about haploid and diploid. Remember that haploid means having only one copy of each chromosome, while diploid means having two copies, or one from each parent. But what if a cell ended up with an entire extra set of chromosomes from one parent? Then the cell would be triploid. Usually, humans and other animals cannot survive being triploid. After all, we know that having just one extra chromosome can have major effects. Imagine having 23 extra chromosomes. Surprisingly, though, some plants actually do quite well in a triploid state. Not only do they survive, but they tend to have larger flowers and fruit and be generally hardier, more resilient organisms. It's important to note that many mutations happen spontaneously, meaning nothing caused them, it's completely unpredictable. However, there are situations that will make mutations more likely to occur. Mutagens, such as radiation, certain toxic chemicals, and infectious agents, such as viruses, are known to increase the likelihood of mutations. Some mutations are completely harmless, like the silent mutation we saw earlier. As long as the same amino acid is made, or one very similar, the protein will still do its job, just like it was meant to. But if it causes a very different sequence of amino acids to be produced, the result can be quite unpredictable. Mutations can happen at many different times during the life cycle of a cell. Are some times more beneficial than others? If a mutation occurs during transcription instead of replication, the mutation will only affect the one protein molecule being made at that specific time, because mRNA molecules are temporary and will be discarded after a single use, so probably not a big deal. Mutations during replication are more significant because every protein made from that DNA strand will be made with the mutation, and every cell that is copied from that cell will have this same mutated DNA. Possibly the worst time for a mutation to occur is during meiosis, because this will be the only copy of DNA that the offspring receives from their parent, and if that copy is altered, the new organism will not have any standard copies at all. Mutations are often associated with cancer, and while the vast majority of mutations do not cause cancer, there are definitely some that do. Any mutation that happens to disrupt the cell cycle could potentially lead to cancer. There are a few specific genes that this is a known risk for, called oncogenes, and mutated copies of these genes can cause cells to begin dividing uncontrollably. One of these genes is known as P53, and over half of cancer cases appear to have a mutated or missing copy of this gene in at least some cells. Also, mutations in the BRCA1 and 2 genes have a very high correlation with breast cancer. The good news is that the more we learn about which mutations cause cancer, the easier it will be to target and treat it. But let's leave off on a more positive note. Some mutations can actually be beneficial. A good example is a mutation that gives natural resistance to the malaria disease, which is often transmitted by mosquitoes. Individuals with mutations in both of their HCB genes have a 93% chance of being immune to malaria. This is very advantageous to people living in parts of the world where malaria transmission is high. Remember that all variation that exists within populations is a result of a mutation that occurred at some point in an ancestor. Beneficial mutations lead to adaptations, which can eventually lead to entirely new species. It may take a lot of mutations to get one that is a win, but given enough time, it's bound to happen eventually. As we went through the lesson today, we saw some examples of point mutations like substitution and frameshift mutations. These mutations could either be silent or missense. We also looked at ways in which entire chromosomes could be inherited with mutations, such as trisomy 21. And then we explored a few things that can increase the chance of mutation and potentially cause diseases like cancer. To finish up our unit on molecular genetics, next time we'll look at some of the ways we use technology to both understand DNA and even sometimes manipulate it. Tune in next time to learn more. And until then, remember, biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey. See you next time.